is Ram from Crossmind Studio. Welcome back to the fourth chapter of Geometry Node series. Today, I wanted to discuss a very basic thing about the material, how you work with the material in Geometry Node system, because for further chapters, in case if we want to render out some interesting images or sequences, so you should be aware of the basic things you need to do in case you want to take out some renders. That is why I just wanted to get this thing out of the way. So usually what happens is when you have anything, what basically happens is you simply click on a new shader, and then you can tweak on the material. And if you have a complex object, then you can add multiple material slots. Basically what we discussed in the introduction series. So in the object editing mode, you have the access to these different components on which you can assign different materials by selecting different faces, assigning different materials. So it's quite straightforward. When it comes to geometry nodes, the process of applying material is a bit different. And the reason behind that is, if I go to the edit mode of this abstract that we had made in the previous chapter, then you won't really be able to select any of these components. That's because our geometry on the editing level is still what we started with. This one Suzanne head, which you might won't be able to see at this moment. So let me just bypass all this geometry. So the input geometry, this Suzanne head, is what we have on the object mode, the editing mode level. The only way to access all this information which is making this cluster is this node network. And within this node network, we have access to the flow, the different sections of the geometry, and that is the only way to access it. Or if you really don't want to keep it procedural and if you want to bake everything, you can always do that, applying the modifier, and then after that you can basically treat it like a regular object. We don't really want to get into that direction. The purpose of geometry node is to have the procedural and more flexible workflow. We don't really want to freeze this geometry and lose access to all these nodes. So I'll just come to the point. So material, in the material section within the geometry node, you have this material assigned. So at this moment it's showing you two different nodes. That's because something is going on in the development. So one of these will be deleted. So just go for the second one at this moment, one with the pink selection, and this is the one which is basically working with the new update. This node, material assigned, let you choose the materials that you have in the scene. So I have quite a few materials in my scene. So let's select this one, bronze material. Just like what we discussed in the previous chapter, try to read the flow of the network that you have. So in this network, we had made five different Suzanne heads and combined all of five heads into one with the joint geometry, and then subdivided the mesh, and then we made this cage with the convex hull, and then we have this glitter going on, the small particles, not really particles but just the spheres. So we have these three sections in our geometry: the Suzanne head, the cage, the web, and then we have this glitter. So if I take this material and plug this right here and try to render this out, what will happen is this material is basically working on everything. And that's because, just try to read the node network. So we have this joint geometry node. So whatever all these three components which are basically making this geometry are coming together here in this node, joint geometry node. And after this point onwards, all of that mesh becomes one. If I bring anything after this point onwards, that is basically going to work on everything in this node network. So if I have a material, so this material is reading all of this geometry, the three different components, as one, because there's a joint geometry node. So what if you wanted to assign material to these three node networks differently? Well, it's quite simple. Just plug this out from here and then go slightly backwards right before the joint geometry node, where you have access to the wires of all these three different components. So let's go to the cage and drop it here. So now our cage is receiving this material, a bronze material that we have. And if I make a duplicate of this and plug this one here, now we have two different materials. So let me just differentiate these two with a different material. So I'll choose a different material here. And similarly, if I make a duplicate of this node, or you can bring in a new node. It's the same process, and choose a different material here. So now the Suzanne heads have this material number one. All of these have this material. The output of the Suzanne head, this wire is basically connecting to this material. The output of cage, the mesh, the wires that we have is connecting to this material. And then the output of the glitter is connecting to this material. So now we have three different materials here. Now, what if you really wanted to bring different materials on all of these five different Suzanne heads? Then exactly the same thing. So instead of this, just plug this material out from here with the alt drag. And instead of putting it here, go back a little in the node network right before the join geometry node, which is basically joining all these five different Suzanne heads. So we'll go to this network and then place it here. So this way you can basically apply different materials to different components. So it's quite simple once you understand it. So I'll just undo these changes. So this is the composition. I'm going to keep these materials which I had prepared. Very simple stuff. If you guys want to see these materials, just let me just show it to you. Material number one is very basic subsurface material with a pointiness and a simple hue color. Material number two is a chrome color, and material number three is a glossy with a bronze-like color. All right. So not really going to get into that. You can always go back and watch chapter number four in introduction series. So this is how you basically apply simple materials in the node network. So another thing I want to discuss with you about material is about the UV. And hopefully this process will be sorted out in the future. But I just wanted to clarify a few things you can do in case UVs are not really working in the geometry node at this moment. And in future, we might have a direct method for this to work. So as long as your geometry node network have a very simple geometry. So here I have one simple cube with a different graphic, and this cube with a different graphic. So if I bring a geometry node network, and in case if you want to bring an external object in the geometry node network, then you'll have to go to the input object info and pick this object. And then the typical things we do, like join geometry, and that will, so I'll hide the original cube, and these are basically two different cubes stacked up. So I just have to do the transform because it's picking the original position. So that is the reason both cubes were overlapping. So anyways, that's another point. Now, if I try to do any complex, like combining multiple geometries or maybe doing a Boolean, then UVs start to disappear. So at this moment, since there is nothing much going on, our UVs are still intact. What I'll do is bring one join geometry node and plug this here, then try to make another cube out of it. Now, as soon as I do that, you can see these two cubes have lost the UV. And let's do maybe point translate or something. Then the UVs of this cube are gone. To solve this, and this only works with the cycles and not really in the AV engine. So what you'll have to do is just go to the original material. Let's go to the shader editor. I have two materials, cube texture and the second cube texture. So instead of bringing the texture coordinates with the control T, if you have the node wrangler enabled, what you'll have to do is type attribute in the search, plug the vector here, and in the field here, you'll have to type the attribute for the UV, and that is UVMAP, UV map. So UVM capital and AP small. And like I said, it's not going to show up in the viewport or in the EV. We'll have to enable the cycles render. And as soon as I do that, our UVs are back. But the thing is, our materials are not really assigned through the node network, and we have this material on everything, and that is the reason we are not able to see the other texture. So what we will do is do the same thing. Material assign, material 1, material 2, and assign here. And we might have to do the attribute thing for the other material as well. So I think, yeah, we only did that for the first material. So I can copy this actually and paste it and do the vector. So it's not really an ideal process. It should be able to pick up UVs on its own. And like I said, it might will be fixed. But till that time, if you are really struggling with the UV or if you really want to access the UV, then this is the process. You'll simply have to go to the texture shader editor, and instead of texture coordinates, you'll have to type the UV map in the attribute field and plug it here. Quite simple. Now let's go back to the main thing that we have made today, and I'll try to make a nice render out of it. I simply have the cycles. Let's set this to 256, enable the denoise, optic X. I have this HDR in the background. So quite simple, flat forest.hexr. Let's hit the render. Here we have our very first render that is made with the geometry nodes. And I know you must be thinking this is not the most exciting thing one can make, but don't worry, we'll slowly get there. So let's just cover things one by one, because else it's just going to become a huge cluster of confusions. So the exciting thing is that we are going to talk about a bit of math and bit of procedural animation in the next chapter, so that we can start adding some sort of a very basic motion, and instead of still we can just have some nice animation loops or something. So in this next chapter, what we will do is create this animation of a clock and all these three pins running in the right format with the geometry nodes. This is just to keep it simple for the very first timers, because understanding math in this format could be a bit tricky. There's nothing much going on. It's all simple value addition, subtraction, multiplication, and all that. But to think of all that in this format might not come as naturally to everyone. We'll do a simple transformation, the rotation and all that, with the geometry nodes, and try to put some math in it, all right? And discuss a few notes. In the chapter after that, we can start creating some beautiful looking abstracts, like what you had might have seen, like audio visualizers or the plexus geometry and all that. So we'll do that in the sixth chapter. So let's get right to the work, and I'll see you guys there. Click right here and let's jump to the next video.